everybody, and welcome on into WWE's The Bump. We just finished watching the 37th annual Survivor Series. My name is Megan Morant. He's Matt Kemp. He's Ryan Pappolla. We have a lot to talk about, you guys. We can't bury the lead. CM Punk is back in WWE after 9 years away. Right off the bat, gentlemen, what is your reaction to this shocking return of CM Punk?
I don't know. I don't have an answer. Look at that graphic. I'm not supposed to be in front of that graphic right there. That's not supposed to happen. It's nearly 10 years back to Royal Rumble 2014. The man hasn't had a singles match on Raw since January of 2014. I don't know what CM Punk's going to do. CM Punk had nothing to do with the end of War Games or how that match went down, and we're not burying that, believe me, but CM Punk is back in WWE is not a sentence I ever expected to hear, and based on what we've seen, Ryan, on social media, nobody did.
I still don't know if I have the proper words to describe this. I know that's my job, to articulate what we just saw. I was shocked. I was sitting next to both of you. Even after we heard Living Color, I wasn't exactly positive we were going to see him walk out.
It's been used as a troll before.
Until we saw him walk out. I have worked here since right after CM Punk left. In my 9 years here, by far, Megan, the most shocking thing I've ever seen here in 9 years.
Well, we were talking about the rumors all night, but then it actually came true. We don't know what he will do next, but we know it will be very exciting. Let's take a look back at the moment that CM Punk shocked the WWE Universe. Absolutely incredible reaction from the WWE Universe at the Allstate Arena in Chicago, Illinois. We know such a historic building, and obviously, Ryan, it means so much for CM Punk to have that moment in his hometown. What did you make of the WWE Universe's reaction?
They wanted him back, right? I mean, like, that energy, that palpable energy. It's Chicago, it's CM Punk. All of that adds up, Matt, but, like, for me, it's just that clear, we want you back, man. And that's what I think everyone's responding to on social, in the arena tonight, everywhere across the board.
12 and a half years ago, I flew myself out from Atlantic City, New Jersey, where I lived at the time, to Chicago to see Money in the Bank 2011. Yeah. There's a special energy in that building anyway. Anybody who has ever been in that building, who's ever had a match in that building, whether it be Hell in a Cell last year with Cody and with Seth, so many great matches, WrestleMania 13, Stone Cold and Bret Hart. But that night in Chicago told me there is a connection there that people wish that they could have with their fans, with the WWE Universe, with fans as a whole. That connection is never going to die for some people. Whether Punk is in this company, he's somewhere else, he's sitting on the couch with Larry the dog, whatever it may be, people love CM Punk. There are people that don't like CM Punk, and he will tell you, I'm not for everybody. Yeah. He doesn't care about that, I think, and that's a big part of this. And when you see what, you know, we're going to get to what Triple H said about him, I think there's going to be other comments, but I also saw a lot of people that are in the ring on Mondays and Tuesdays and Fridays going, oh, he's back. Yeah. There's a genuine excitement and enthusiasm from people that grew up watching CM Punk who are now here in WWE, and there's that side of the coin. There's also a lot of people that love to get in there and punch him in the face.
Right, but Megan, real quick, to that point, though, it's a very singular thing on either side of that discussion, right? Because to your point, it's just a unique, a very, very, very unique energy. And so when he arrives, regardless of what you are thinking something that is very, very, very singular to CM Punk.
Well, this changes the entire landscape of WWE, and whether you love CM Punk or you hate CM Punk gives a reaction, and Triple H talked about that at the WWE press conference immediately after Survivor Series.
It's been a long time. And in some ways, been a long time coming. You know, you could say this about CM Punk. Love him, hate him, positive, negative, whatever you want to say. People talk about him all the time. He is a magnet for that. He is a conversation starter. And it's tough to look past that. And for me, if our fans want it, if the WWE Universe is excited to have it, then let's go. A lot of time has gone by, almost 10 years, right? And if you are the same person you were 10 years ago, 10 years later, you've messed up. Everybody grows, everybody changes. And I'm a different person, he's a different person. This is a different company, and we're all on the same even starting ground. So, what's next for CM Punk? That'll be interesting, won't it? Yeah, I'm interested to see that myself. I know whatever it is, it'll be talked about. It'll be exciting, and it'll be a thrill ride for the WWE Universe, no matter what it is. And I'm thrilled. We're all thrilled. To have him back here and to have him back, you know, cliched to say, but have him back home in WWE. It's where he belongs.
The reaction on social media continues, but of course we see the picture. Triple H with the iconic point. Mighty cold day in hell. Hashtag Survivor Series. Oh boy.
That's the wildest picture in the history of the company. Do you agree, Matt?
I mean... Listen, I'm not saying anything out of school here. That picture existing, I said it's not AI. Because it looks like that, right? It looks, sure. You see Triple H and CM Punk next to each other like that in front of that logo. That looks fake. It's not fake. I don't know if either one of those men a year ago would have said that was going to be the case, much less 10 years ago. And that picture now exists. This is the timeline we are living in, a very unpredictable timeline. By the way, we have yet to talk about Randy Orton. We have yet to talk about Charlotte Flair and Becky Lynch sitting next to each other after being successful in War Games. That is what is going on right now on a premium live event that have five excellent matches with so much to talk about that picture exists. And what we'll be talking about on Monday, we'll be talking about it Tuesday, we'll talk about right here on The Bump on Wednesday. And I don't know where it goes from here. I think that's the fun of this, Ryan. We're on the road to WrestleMania in Philadelphia, yep. And it took a wild detour all of a sudden.
For sure, and to everything you just said, to piggyback off of that, to Triple H's point, Megan, in terms of what's next, all of our minds are going to wander about what's next for CM Punk, but for right now, for tonight, you're watching this on Sunday morning, man, this was just so cool, right? And that seems like overly simplistic analysis, and there's so much fun to talk about from what we saw Saturday night in Chicago, but this is one of the biggest moments in the history of WWE. Let's celebrate and enjoy it as it's happening. What's next is what's next.
And Ryan, you know? Speaking of celebrating, we all had our own reactions to CM Punk's return, but fans in the Allstate Arena in Chicago were absolutely electric. This guy had a front row seat to witness it all.
Welcome home!
a reaction is outpouring on social media. What more is there to say? CM Punk is back. I can't believe it. The WWE Universe can't believe it. X is buzzing. I don't have the words to explain any of this. Elsewhere on social media, CM Punk actually returned. Amazing. We heard the rumbling
throughout
the week. Two Kings, One Night. Welcome back, boys. Hashtag
Lena
Randy
Vega.
Orton, CM Punk, WWE Survivor Series. Zelina Vega chiming in. We'd love to hear it from Zelina Vega, and we do have to talk about the rest of what happened at War Games, because we haven't even gotten to Randy Orton's return yet. And in the main event, it was an absolutely epic War Games in this battle between the Judgment Day, Sami Zayn, Cody Rhodes, Randy Orton, Seth freaking Rollins. These guys put on a show. And man, was it good to see the Viper come back, RKO out of nowhere, and help his team pick up the victory. Obviously, the crossroads by Cody Rhodes over Damian Priest was able to get the job done.
Well, Randy made us all wait. He made his team wait, which is kind of fun. We got a near cash-in, which I guess Randy kind of stopped. Usually there's RKOs out of nowhere. That was the most telegraphed and beautifully telegraphed RKO we've ever seen. We'll get to that, but right here, when Randy doesn't come out as the final member of his team, not in the shark cage, Rhea comes out instead. She's got a briefcase. She's got the ref. We might get a cash in. Could Seth freaking Rollins have just been put through a table the hard way? Randy comes out. Stop that. Hits his first RKO on Dirty Dom, which was absolutely the perfect way to come back with an RKO after 18 months. And right here, Jay taking care of business. Randy said, hey, remember, 18 months ago, it was you and your brother who took me out. Jay says, my bad. My bad. There's the RKO we were waiting for. A perfect way to come back. He takes care of Damian on the same page. And JD McDonagh, welcome to the Judgment Day. That is telegraphed. It was beautifully done. A lot of teamwork there, Ryan.
Randy was just like right here. He like created
this
a drop
is the spot,
zone for
please.
JD McDonagh. It's the best shape I've ever seen Randy Orton.
Oh my goodness!
Without question.
And that's saying something considering Randy Orton. That's Randy Orton that we're talking about. This is wild to say in a War Games match, Matt and Megan. Randy looked like he was having fun out there. He was
blessed.
Like, you know, and it was so great to see him back. It was also, to your point about Jay and Randy, there was no issues between Cody and Seth. There was no issues between Jay and Randy. It was as well-oiled a War Games team as I've ever seen.
Well, I want to talk about that for just a moment. Obviously, Randy has been away from WWE, recovering from injury for the last 18 months, but sending him to that road to recovery was the Usos and the Bloodline. This was the first time that he would see not only the WWE Universe, but Jey Uso, and they had to work on the same team. For a moment there, I was concerned about the chemistry and if these two would be able to coexist. They quickly put their differences aside, and that shows how powerful the Judgment Day is and how these guys need to work together to turn them down. They put it beside them, and I thought that was very impressive to turn the page so quickly.
It's a really good point, but it's also a credit to Jay and Randy, because Randy did hear voices for a few seconds. He was looking at Jay, to your point. We didn't know exactly what was going to happen. Jay quickly, you kind of pointed it out in real time, that he's like, ooh, I'm sorry.
I'm good. I'm sorry. Yeah, he said it in the moment. But yeah. Jay's had to do a lot of that.
Yeah.
When Jay got sent over to Raw and the deal that ended up sending Kevin over to SmackDown, Jay knew what he was walking into. He's had Sammy by his side. Cody's like, hey, he cost me the world championship. I could have been universal champion this year. I'm okay with it. Drew McIntyre, obviously, not happy about it. Randy Orton has issues. Jay took care of that right away. Jay took care of that in the moment. I don't know if it was much about a Judgment Day. I think it was, hey, this is my teammate. Maybe a good business decision by Jey Uso to take care of Randy Orton in the moment. When Randy Orton's looking at that, Randy Orton talked to us on this very show about a year ago, celebrating his 20 years. You mentioned how he was smiling in the match. I'm not necessarily surprised. I think this is a Randy Orton who is appreciating the fact that he could still do this. Yeah. And that was before the injury we talked about him. Now he's back after 18 months. He's got a wife, family at home, big family. the fact that he still wants to get in there, I think he was happy to step into War Games. I think he was happy to hear Chicago love him, though. I think he's appreciating those moments more. Not to say he won't drop anybody he wants with an RKO tomorrow night on Raw, because that's very much going to probably happen to somebody. Yep. Or on SmackDown. Or in NXT. I think a couple people could use an RKO down there. But what is this Randy Orton? What are his goals? He's done it all, right? He's close to the record for most world championships. Is that a goal for him? Is it getting in there with people he hasn't gotten there before? He met JD McDonough the hard way tonight. Yeah. He met Dirty Dom with an RKO. Where is he going? What are his motivations? Does he care about Damian Priest? Does he care about the Judgment Day? We're talking all about CM Punk's motivations, which is a big story. But where is Randy Orton at this point in his career, two decades in?
Well, and to that point, I think it was a really, really cool moment that he hits that unreal RKO. But he says, you know what, Cody? Damian's there. You two have had your issues. You know, you were the one who made this call to me. I don't know if Randy Orton 10 years ago, granted, 10 years ago, he was just about after Legacy. I don't know if 10 years ago that would have happened. You're right. It's a different mentality. And I think it's a really good mentality for a War Games match because Randy's coming into this very personal situation, a bit removed from it. Granted, he clearly wanted to kick Judgment Day's heads off still. Ultimately, he was a pivotal part of their victory tonight. It was huge.
And that meant a lot to Cody Rhodes because this was Cody Rhodes' first time participating in a War Games match. Remember, it was Chicago, a special place to so many, especially Cody Rhodes. But this War Games is what Cody Rhodes' father created. So very special for him to be able to pick up the victory for his team. And you guys, he was busy throughout the week. He was making calls to Randy. Randy was running late. Cody had a lot on his plate. And then to prepare for his first War Games match and pick up the victory, how special is this moment for Cody Rhodes?
He's been preparing for this since 1987. Yeah. I mean, his father created this match. Michael Cole talked all about that. You go back to the Omni, which was referenced by our friend X-Pac right here on The Bump last week. And the meaning behind Atlanta, Georgia, behind that family, for his father to create the match and for Cody to never get the opportunity to step in. When Adam Pearce made that announcement on Raw a couple of weeks ago, it was an absolute melee. But when you caught Cody for 1 second, there was a smile he could not keep off of his face. The poster, which looked exactly like his dad talking about the great Kabuki back in the day with that military paint on his face. He couldn't wait to step in there. He couldn't wait to show off his gear. And to get the victory in that, I think, checks a box off for Cody in his career. It is part of the story.
Yeah.
It's not a story, I think, that he's expected to tell. It's gone a lot of different ways. But this is one of those things where you could say, I stepped in there for the first time. I stepped in front of a sold-out crowd in Chicago. Randy Orton was back with me, and I won the match.
Yeah, I think when, you know, we've talked about the story extensively, right? And when you're talking about the story, every single piece is very monumental to where he's trying to get to. But I think if you truth serum Cody, he would say tonight was as special, if not more special, than any other moment so far because of the familial connection, because of what it meant. Again, much like Randy, it's weird to say for a War Games match. He was having a blast out there.
Well, congratulations to Cody Rhodes and the rest of his teammates for defeating the Judgment Day and Drew McIntyre at War Games. Well, sticking with War Games, we're going to head on over to the Women's War Games match. We were wondering throughout the week, will there be a way that Charlotte Flair and Becky Lynch can coexist inside War Games, this brutal matchup? They proved that they indeed can, as the team of Charlotte Flair, Becky Lynch, Bianca Belair, and Shotzi picked up a massive victory over Damage Control. And you guys, we can't talk about this matchup without talking about what Io Sky did from the top of the cage, putting the trash can over her body. As we see right here, this was absolutely unbelievable, but not surprising coming from Io in a War Games match.
She's done it before. She did it in an NXT War Games match. It's a little different in front of an absolutely packed to the rafters All-State Arena. This is what Io does. Io's got more War Games matches than anybody in WWE because she knows what she's doing out there. We'll get to the winners in a second. Damage Control came out with a plan because right after that, Asuka came in as the last member. Yep. Because they did not have the advantage, thanks to Ruffles. But then they didn't win.
Yeah.
I want to say something here. Bayley did a great job. The entire
Incredible
time.
Incredible job.
Corey Graves said it. I said it out loud. He said it as, so that's the MVP right now. Mm-hmm. She was stopping pinfalls. She was in there from the jump. She did everything she possibly could. And she won't say this out loud. to prove herself to the rest of Damage Control, because I think she kind of feels like she has to right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, Matt, you've been talking about it. She's not in the group chat that we knew of.
I don't know.
We were speculating.
I just watched body language. I'm a body language expert. Yes. They don't really look at her very much.
It seems like she wasn't in the group chat, and she was trying to prove herself, to your point, and you can't do much of a better job than Bayley did inside that match for her teammates.
There can't be, I don't think, any more questioning her intentions. By the way, to Matt's point, we are speculating a lot on both ends of the coin. I also tend to think that Bayley is trying to prove herself. Damage Control, the rest of the group, has said all of the right things, and you would think that they would now mean all of the right things when it comes to Bayley after that performance tonight. With that said, if I'm Bayley, I would be a little concerned that you could say, well, Bayley ultimately is the reason. Dakota Kai, by the way, was everywhere in this thing. I would hope Bayley, if there was any doubt when it comes to the Damage Control and her of it all, that that doubt is now gone. But also the biggest part of that, the biggest reason for that, is because Bianca, Charlotte, Shotzi, and Becky were on fire this entire match.
Well, this moment that we referenced earlier with Io Sky, just absolutely incredible. And immediately after it happened, it shifted the momentum in Damage Control's favor until this happened. Charlotte Flair off the top of the cage, annihilating everyone below. But then, can they coexist?
What?
This is more than coexisting.
How did WarGames give us so many happy moments? Like, heart-tugging moments right here. And what we saw on SmackDown two nights ago, of course, and, you know, when we talk about Becky and Charlotte, the phone call, there's a lot of fences to be mended.
Yeah. Yes.
Whether it be the matches that they've had, the back and forth that they've had, the belt exchanges, the title exchanges that they've had, and they came back together. They're together at the presser. Kind of nice to see. Like, I didn't expect it. I would have been fine with, like, listen, they don't like each other. It's part of the business. Let them go battle. Sure. I'll watch them go wrestle each other. That's great. There was something that made me happy to see them back together at their absolute peaks. We haven't seen that from this version of Becky and this version of Charlotte with everything that they've accomplished. Everything they did coming up, okay, cool. It's two people fighting for the top. They're both at the top. There's no doubting that. They're both future Hall of Famers. Is this going to go further now is the question.
We were overjoyed when we saw it happen. Social was definitely overjoyed when they saw it happen. Becky and Charlotte hugging out. I mean, that was us watching it together in the room. I'm not going to lie to you, Megan and Matt. On Friday night, I didn't have a lot of hope that this was going to go well.
I'm right there with you.
I really had a lot of doubts, and especially when you're facing someone the level of Damage Control, you need to be on the same page.
Yeah, I got to be honest. Even when they came out and everybody was wearing pink except Becky, I said, oh, no, this is not going to go well. Yeah. And that hug in the ring proved us and so many others wrong.
And we saw it because ultimately, to go to Men's War Games for a second, Drew and Damian clearly weren't on the same page. Ultimately, they didn't get it done. You need that cohesion in the setting that is War Games. There's a lot of history like Matt talked about. It's a hug I never thought I would see. A lot of things happened at Survivor Series that I never thought I would see here in WWE. I don't know where it goes. It's a step back for Damage Control. But now the sky's the limit for Becky and Charlotte, both individually and possibly as a unit. But to have the weight off of their backs of this issue for them, I think will be big for both of them, even singles competition.
They're not answering those questions anymore. Yeah. I don't think they should have. Now it's what's next? Where do you two go from here? But where does Damage Control go from here? Yeah. Because Bayley put in a performance that we cannot stop talking about. Michael Cole even said, wow, what? And think about Michael Cole's history with Bayley. There is something to be said for what she did in that ring.
Yep.
She was in there last year. They didn't win last year. She's in there this year. She did everything to make sure Damage Control could win. She's there at the end as a loss.
Yep.
If I'm Damage Control, I look at Bayley and go, wow, she did everything she could. But Io Sky is still the WWE Women's Champion. Asuka's very happy to be part of the group. Kairi Sane's only had now two matches back in WWE. And Dakota Kai seems to be, I don't want to say caught in the middle, because it doesn't feel like she's caught in the middle.
I'll be honest, I don't think she's anywhere close to caught
in the middle.
I will say
this. If I'm Bayley, maybe invest a little Duolingo. Maybe learn a little Japanese, because Dakota knows what the rest of them are saying. And Bayley's like, oh, yeah, sure, they're saying the good things about me. But I think Bayley did everything she possibly could to say, listen, I'm with you. I want to be part of this, whether I'm the leader or not. I don't know if Damage Control will look at it that way. They certainly should.
They'll look at it one of two ways.
But for the victors tonight, it wasn't just Charlotte Flair's unbelievable moment from the top of the cage, but Becky Lynch with the manhandle slam, able to pick up the victory, both women getting their spot in the bright lights, and then the team standing tall at the end. But let's take another look back at this unbelievable moment from Charlotte Flair off the top of the War Games cage, climbing all the way up of there. The strength in Charlotte, the length in her to do this moonsault off the top. Guys, I couldn't believe this.
It was it's almost a moonsault and a half if you really watch it, which is insane in its own right.
And a kick out by Bayley. Yeah, I want to note that one more time.
That's another feather in Bayley's cap tonight. But also, you said it earlier, the momentum shift that Io had when she came off the top, it looked like Damage Control was going to route their way to victory. What Charlotte does there changes the complexion of the match, and then there's the hug, and then we go from there. Also, by the way, I would be remiss. Shotzi showed up and showed out this one.
What a spot for her.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, she's in there with icons of the game. Damage Control is such a cohesive unit. She more than represented herself tonight. She was invaluable. Charlotte is able to do the things she does. Becky's able to do the things she does. Bianca, by the way, with two braids was awesome.
But unlocked something there.
Yeah, yes.
But think of where Shotzi was last year, right? Fighting for the SmackDown Women's Championship, unable to come through at the time. We spoke to her on the bump that day. She was very emotional about what she was taking into that. I think she was looking back and going, look, here's another chance. This is a perfect match for me. And she comes out on the winning side. What does that mean for her? She certainly wanted some revenge on Damage Control and everything they did. When you win the match like this, I then wonder what happens next, because now you're not a team anymore.
Yeah.
You know, now it's, well, I want a chance at Io Sky. I want to parlay this into something more. I'd like to know where this all goes from here. But a big night for a team that wasn't a team a week and a half ago.
And we actually have Kathy Kelly caught up with this team that wasn't a team a week ago, because they were victorious at Survivor Series War Games. Kathy, take it away.
I'm here with this crew that you all know, Becky Lynch, Charlotte Flair, Bianca Belair, and Shotzi, fresh off their win, War Games Survivor Series. Now, an incredible match, but arguably the other team was a little bit more cohesive coming into this. How do you guys feel? Looks like a little tea was shared after the match as well.
I think we just concentrate on the positives and we forget the negatives, you know? We let bygones be bygones.
We all had tea together.
Yeah.
We all had tea together.
Party. Yes. How you start, it's about how you finish, okay? Yes. And Becky came through for us. Charlotte did her thing, and we all did our thing. You know, it's about how you finish. So we got the W today. So
we finished very strong.
Yeah, we finished. I mean, you do have the EST on the team, the strongest, but I want to toot my own horn too. But yeah, you know.
And the craziest.
The craziest.
I'm gonna go back to Raw. Let me know if y'all need me again.
We appreciate you.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming through. Thanks
That's
for
my make, man.
Thanks for making that call. Couldn't have done it without you.
I'm too kind.
Well, even though Becky's off to Raw, I have to ask you guys, how are you three going to celebrate this win?
With lots of smiles.
I'm going to go have some more tea.
Okay.
More tea. Then a little workout in the morning together.
Okay.
I'm not working out.
Okay.
I'm eating pizza.
Oh, we're going for pizza.
Yeah, let's get some pizza.
Okay, we're gonna go this way.
Okay. Maybe I'll get some pizza too.
Where are you guys going? You going to the gym? You going to get pizza? I think we're all going to get pizza.
Becky went to Raw for 5 seconds and then came back because she wanted pizza.
She loves deep dish.
That was awesome.
She loves the deep dish pizza in Chicago. Congratulations to those women. You cannot wipe the smile off their faces after that amazing victory at Survivor Series War Games. Well, elsewhere at War Games, it was two men that are synonymous with the Intercontinental title battling it out in Chicago. But Gunther continues his historic reign. Gunther was in this very bump studio just weeks ago, talking about the lack of respect that he has for The Miz. I think his tone would change a little bit on that after what we saw at Survivor Series War Games, because this was a very game Miz. Matt, we talked about Gunther maybe awakening something in The Miz. we saw that on display.
Yeah, and he will not change his tone whatsoever because this is Gunther and he does things a certain way, and it's not the way Miz does certain things. However, there's two ways to get anywhere you want to go when you think about Gunther being now the longest reigning continuing Intercontinental Champion of all time, Miz being an eight-time Intercontinental Champion, 592 combined days with that championship. Will remain at 592. You can go about things two different ways, but Gunther defeated The Miz. Gunther's not going to change his tune. He even said, he went on all of our social media and said, all right, I did it again. I'm the man. I am the guy who is synonymous with this great heavyweight championship that is over my shoulder. I am the greatest Intercontinental Champion. I thought, Ryan, if Miz was able to defeat Gunther, he ties the record at 9. Yeah. He knocks off the man with the longest reign ever. You could have said Miz could have made the case to be the greatest Intercontinental Champion. Some still may think that. But I think Gunther needed to knock somebody else off that was synonymous with that championship. He did. Miz did a great job. But right now, I don't care who's facing Gunther. We're in Roman territory. We do this all the time. Yeah. We don't pick against Gunther.
Did The Miz earn the respect of Gunther, though, with his
publicly? No.
He'll never say
he
it.
He will
That's
never
right.
say
He'll
that.
Never say
he
it.
Doesn't like how Miz does things. He sat in the studio and talked about every other great Intercontinental Champion. Somebody's like, this guy's great. Somebody goes, this was terrible. This is a dark age in this industry, in this great sport. He's not going to give Miz that love, at least not right now. And I think that's a difference in philosophy, Ryan. That's all that is.
I agree. Miz had an excellent strategy. I'm not joking when I say this. Just stay in the damn fight. And this was the epitome of just stay in the damn fight.
This
right?
is Miz.
Because, yeah, and like ultimately, Gunther doesn't like that Miz operates this way. But Miz had to hang around long enough to find a moment. This was the moment. It was perfectly crafted by Miz. Now, it doesn't work out here. And I will say this. Oof. I will say this because this may get lost in the shuffle, Matt and Megan. A lot, rightfully so, will be made of Miz's resilience coming out of this match. None of us up here, thought that Miz's heart was ever in question. We don't necessarily always talk about Gunther's resilience because we do not have
Correct.
To. He usually is so dominant and never even comes up. We did just see that man get low blowed twice and still find a way to
and the turnbuckle.
Yeah, yeah, to decisively win. So that's bad news for the rest of the locker room, by the way, because again, we don't necessarily think of it, but Gunther is as resilient as they come, which is why we are in the territory with him that
he
we are.
He beats you down physically.
Yeah.
And beats you down. I say this all the time. Gunther only has his kind of match. He doesn't have to adapt to anybody else. Everybody tries to go at him a different way. Miz played out of the Miz playbook. He still had Chicago behind him, but he played out of the Miz playbook. It's the right move. But what Gunther can do mentally is you could throw everything at him, and he throws that clothesline. I said it while we were watching. I said, there is not a clothesline right now that is as devastating as his that can just cut off anything you're doing since JBL and the clothesline from hell. He did it in this match. He crushes you mentally because you think, all right, come on. If I just get him down, if I can just cut him, whatever it may be, this will be the chance. And he's got a good chin. He could dig deep. Yep. He's got great resilience. He's got great car. He checks all the boxes that you would want of someone to be physical and have all of the heart for the business, but also to say, yeah, you can keep knocking me down. I'll get right back up. That's what Gunther is. He has a lot of people beat, I think, sometimes before the bell even rings because no one's figured it out so far.
Yeah, and Gunther's reign continues, this reign of dominance. And Jackie Redmond caught up with Gunther after his historic reign continued at Survivor Series WarGames.
Well, Gunther, congratulations. Your run as the longest reigning Intercontinental Champion of all time continues after your win over The Miz tonight. Just your thoughts on the battle that you had with The Miz tonight here at Survivor Series WarGames.
My thoughts were very clear. I always deliver what I promise. And if there were any doubts till now, I think I can officially claim to be the greatest and longest reigning Intercontinental Heavyweight Champion of all time.
Well, coming into this match, you were very clear to The Miz's face that you had zero respect for him. Have you gained any respect after that match?
Let me say it like this. Mike definitely proved that he's up for a fight. He definitely proved that he belongs in that ring. Just not with the Ring General. Thank you.
Check out this reaction from social media. You could put Gunther against a broom and you'll get a heater. Hashtag Survivor Series. Look at that image there. Gunther has yet to miss during his legendary Intercontinental title run. The Ring General reigns supreme. And elsewhere, Gunther and The Miz delivered. What a match. Absolutely agree with you, Tyler. And you guys, I know we said Gunther would never admit it. I thought for just one split second there with Jackie Redmond that he was about to. But it does seem like he's looking at The Miz a little bit more than a sports entertainer.
Well, see, here's the thing. This is another thing I don't think he'll ever admit publicly. He probably did overlook Miz.
Yes.
Gunther never overlooks anyone. Maybe just a smidgen he was looking past this one. But again, he figures it out, gets the W. This is now very, very bad news for everyone that will have to face him after the fact, because he will not do that again on this reign. Gunther downloads data better than anybody on the roster. He will not make that same mistake again, even though it wasn't even really a mistake, Matt, because he got the dub.
Because what he does is evolve his game up here.
Yep.
I think him, and it's interesting because it's one of his greatest rivals, Ilya Dragunov, what he's doing right now as the NXT champion. There's a lot of similarities, and these two obviously battled, had great battles. But a lot of what they did was, when the bell rings, I'm in the ring, I'm going to beat you. We have seen the evolution of Ilya Dragunov and how much more he has brought to the table and how he starts to talk a little bit differently now and the confidence he has. Gunther has been on the bump a few times, and typically it's just like, I'm happy to defend my championship and I'll take on all comers, and he sat in here a couple times. There's a little bit more verbal confidence out of Gunther that he is willing to tell you about.
Yeah.
First it was, I don't want to celebrate a championship reign. Then he had a celebration on Raw, and he's like, yeah, I'm the man. And he is. There's no doubting that. He's not lying to anybody, and he backs it up. I like that about Gunther. I think that's only going to take him to higher and higher places. Standing in there with The Miz days before having that match and going back and forth saying, Miz, I watched all you. I've seen everything you do. You got bullied. I'm going to be the bully now. You're weird like all these people. Now there's more mental warfare when it comes to Gunther. And you know what? He has every right to talk that way. I think it's the natural evolution we're seeing of a man who believes he's at the top, who has what he believes is the greatest prize in this company, the Intercontinental Heavyweight Championship, and still has more to accomplish with that title and maybe other championships down the road.
And that's the key, the more to accomplish, because Gunther knows that at any moment in WWE, if you are not prepared, a title can slip away. Well, speaking of dominant champions, it's hard to say those two words without talking about Rhea Ripley, because she has been one of the most dominant champions in WWE. Tonight, that continued as she picked up a victory over Zoe Stark. A big opportunity for Zoe Stark. The biggest match in her career, but really tough to overcome Mommy, even though she's had her hands in a lot of areas lately dealing with Judgment Day business. When it's time for Mommy to defend her title, much like Gunther, she delivers.
That's the thing, though. She's doing so many other things. She's the power broker of WWE. She's the straw that stirs the drink on Monday Night Raw. And she's dealing with Judgment Day business and the men's WarGames match and the plan to have Damian Priest cash in. And then she has a match and she takes care of business against Zoe Stark. And Zoe Stark put her on her butt a few times. That DDT in the ring apron, I said, oh, this is it. And yet, Rhea Ripley retains. And I think very much like Gunther, you go, what do I do? She got in there with four great challengers at Crown Jewel. She walked out as champion. She got in there with a Zoe Stark who had nothing else to think about than the biggest match of her career in Chicago with a chance for the Women's World Championship. She did not back down. There was not a second, Ryan, from the lead up to this match to in Chicago where she was like, there was no doubting what Zoe Stark was going to bring to the table. She was there. She had answers for Mommy. But she didn't have the final answer.
Yeah, Rhea Ripley can handle everything.
Yes. Right?
And that goes, it's multi-layered. She can handle all of the business going on, whether it's Finn and Damian having problems, Damian and Drew having problems. We're talking to Paul Heyman every now and again. She can handle all that stuff. And then when she's in the ring, Zoe Stark busts out unique offense. Rhea Ripley stops her. Zoe Stark is coming up aerial, everything, every which way. Rhea Ripley is not phased. Rhea Ripley can handle everything. And at this point, for the rest of the women's division, I don't know how you can go into a match with Rhea Ripley and craft a strategy that you can feel confident in. She is strategy-proof at this point, and she has been since before WrestleMania, but especially since April.
We talk about the numbers game with Judge Bay all the time. That was one-on-one.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was Rhea Ripley dominating and walking out as champion. I think the turning point in her career was WrestleMania 36 against Charlotte Flair when she lost the NXT Women's Championship, when she went in there in her first WrestleMania. Very different times, we know that. We're in the middle of a pandemic. She gets challenged by Charlotte Flair for the NXT Women's Championship because Charlotte wins the Royal Rumble, and she lost. And then we go through a lot of different times. And when we came out of the pandemic for those first live shows in Texas, I remember the crowd reactions to Rhea being much louder than we had heard in the past. And I think she's kind of listened, and she's taken that all in, and she's felt more of that spotlight, which only gotten bigger and bigger and bigger, and she's handled it all. And I think that night in Orlando changed her career for the better because she learned, okay, here's the big spotlight. I couldn't come through. I'll never let that happen again. And look what she's done ever since.
But exactly. And she's operating on a completely different level than almost anybody in WWE. And we all had our fair share of questions. Does Rhea have too much on her plate with the Judgment Day? Does she have her hand?
We got to stop asking that question.
And she clearly does not, because we saw exactly what she did to Zoe Stark. And this is a Zoe Stark while new to the roster. She has been extremely impressive. We saw what she did with Trish Stratus. We saw what she did to earn her way into this match. Can Rhea Ripley, is it possible for her to take this even higher?
Oh, for sure. I mean, Rhea Ripley, there's zero doubt with Rhea Ripley at this point. You talk about WrestleMania 36. It was a new terrain, right? It was new experiences.
Totally new. Bright lights.
At this point, again, I think this happened from before WrestleMania, but it's been a different level since. It's just you don't really necessarily always realize the evolution of a superstar in real time. But with Rhea Ripley, we are being cognizant of it. Because if you want to contrast from WrestleMania 36 or even 37 to tonight at Survivor Series, when Zoe Stark, to your point, came with a lot of really great offense. She brought out things that we had never seen before. She was willing to take chances. It didn't matter. It just didn't matter.
It's not a knock on Zoe either.
No, Zoe was great.
Yeah. We have to give Zoe her kudos because she truly was fantastic in this match against the Women's World Champion. We see the reaction on social media. Molly here, so happy Rhea retained her title. Zoe put on a hell of a performance and still Survivor Series. Molly, we're right there with you. Here's another reaction from Ella J. A picture of Rhea versus Zoe with some fire emojis. Ella, we love the fire emojis. That is how you describe Mommy. She's always bringing the heat and she's always on top. She remains on top after her victory over Zoe Stark again. We have to give our kudos to Zoe Stark because it was a hell of a performance against the Women's World Champion. Elsewhere at Survivor Series War Games, Matt, last night I asked you on the SmackDown Lowdown, who had the most to gain out of Survivor Series War Games? You told me Santos Escobar. He did that against Dragon Lee, picking up the victory. This was a match that became official on Friday night, SmackDown, after Santos Escobar took out Carlito. Dragon Lee stepping up to the plate and taking on Santos in what would be the biggest match of his career. You guys, Dragon Lee put on another hell of a fight. Speaking of Zoe, Dragon Lee, hell of a fight. But Santos proved that his path of
anger, destruction, yes, you name this, it right now.
This continues. And
jealousy.
He's rage, a very different Santos than content. We saw just a few weeks ago.
Bitterness.
This is so intriguing to me because you have two men who came from the lucha style, who came and grew up watching Rey Mysterio. And you'll have lucha matches. Ryan, we were talking about Nitro from 1997 as we watch this match, as we watch Dragon Lee. Not always so contentious, though. More about the art of it and how beautiful things can be. Santos Escobar is not trying to be beautiful right now. We've talked to him so many times about what lucha means to him. So what does he do? He tears away at the mask, a mask that he wore at a time in his career, a mask that is sacred to his father.
That's what it means.
That's where Santos is at right now. I like this Santos Escobar. I don't have to deal with this Santos Escobar, but this is a Santos Escobar that I think needed to be unlocked. I think it was good for him to be part of the LWO. I think it's good that, and I don't think he'll ever regret having that tattoo on his hand because he believed in what the LWO could be and represent in 2023 and beyond. That belief went away when Carlito became part of the LWO. I don't know if I necessarily knock Santos for thinking that way. Now, what he has done since then, putting Rey Mysterio on the shelf, trying to do the same to Dragon Lee, putting Carlito on the shelf, looking right at that camera at the end of the match saying, Rey, that was for you. I hope you were watching.
Santos Escobar is on a mission, right? And so I also don't believe that Santos Escobar believes he is wrong about any single thing that he has said so far. He thinks Carlito is responsible for all of this. He thinks Rey Mysterio turned his back on Santos Escobar. Dragon Lee was incredible in this match.
Yeah.
But Santos Escobar is on a mission, and that mission doesn't just include defeating Dragon Lee. It includes embarrassing him. You and I thought it was going to be worse for Dragon Lee after the fact. I wouldn't have been shocked if it happened. They have unlocked, to use your word, something in Santos Escobar that we saw during his NXT days.
And I was going to point that out because Wade Barrett said on the kickoff show that Santos Escobar has never changed. I mean, we saw a little change with him in the LWO, but this is who Santos always was when he was down in NXT. Are you guys seeing that same thing out of Santos right now?
Yes, to an even higher level, because I think there's experience that comes along with that. There's the experience he had in Mexico. There's the experience he had working out in Boyle Heights, California. There's the experience in NXT, you know, running Legado del Fantasma. Legado del Fantasma becomes LWO. Tries to take those guys. Hey, you're still with me, right?
Yeah.
No, we're not. Okay, fine. You're not with me. You're added to the list right now. Santos Escobar is a very intense individual, very confident individual. From the day I first met him at the Performance Center, nothing has changed. That's how he always is. He takes all of this very seriously, but it's in his heart. I think he's now thinking more with his head because he realizes sometimes you got to do that to get to the top.
And Megan, to compare to NXT, he had some personal issues down there, but he never cared as much about what he does right now in comparison to any of that, which isn't to say that stuff wasn't personal. But again, he loves possibly still Rey Mysterio, yet the mind frame he is in right now, a man that he would claim that he loves and did so much for and was his hero.
He was his hero.
He says he wants his leg to basically...
He said Dom was right. He said Dom was right.
Which are harsh words.
It's the worst thing you could say.
Say the least. It's the worst thing you could say to a father. I mean, to
it's literally the worst thing you could say in all of WWE right now is Dom was right. Sorry, Mommy.
Santos Escobar picking up the victory over Dragon Lee. You guys, he's been impressive since he's been on the blue brand. And this is someone that Rey Mysterio has said is the future of Lucha Libre. I think he showed a little bit of that in every single match that we've seen him in. Wasn't able to get the job done. But you got to think that the LWO is sitting at home watching this and thinking of what they can do to help not only Dragon Lee, but, you know, the remnants of LWO to get back at Santos Escobar.
Well, they have a problem on their hands, for sure, because this isn't going to stop. I mean, that was the one big takeaway I took from it. Again, the mission isn't over because he took care of Dragon Lee tonight. There's still a lot more that Santos feels and wants to take care of. Dragon Lee was great. He never got rattled. The mask got ripped. He never got rattled. An incredibly impressive performance. But Santos Escobar's rage, to me, is the story that's going to keep coming out of this.
Dragon Lee will learn from this. Dragon Lee took this match on because he's been asking Nick all this. Just please keep giving me more. Let me step in here. And he does this on a day's notice.
Yeah.
He steps into Chicago. Sold out crowd. Santos Escobar. Not with a lot of personal animosity that's really been built up other than a week or two. And said, let me have this. He knew what a win would mean. He didn't get the win. He's not done. He's far from done. I also think Santos Escobar was intentional in his actions. I think he left a little bit. I think he wants to continue to go after Dragon Lee, to go after the LWO. He wants to make this much worse for them before they can come back at him at all. So I think what he did to Dragon Lee is just the beginning and continuation of his feelings towards Rey Mysterio. This is ultimately still going to come back to Rey Mysterio.
Well, let's find out what's going on in the mind of Santos Escobar. He's standing by with Byron Saxton.
Santos Escobar, congratulations are in order for you. A dominant victory over Dragon Lee. But I would imagine Carlito was probably watching tonight's match. And I would also imagine that you will have a bullseye on your back as Carlito will be looking for revenge.
Byron, tonight at Survivor Series War Games, it was a night for teaching lessons. Lesson number one was for you. You used very small words before. But see, after my match, now you're using big words. Victory. Dominant. But easy on the imagination. Because I don't care if Carlito was watching or not. He doesn't live on my mind, on my thoughts. Ray, on the other hand, I know he was watching, and I know his hopes were with Dragon Lee. But see, like I said, tonight was a night for teaching lessons. And this blood is a testament for what I said before. Byron, let them know. If you mess with Santos Escobar, this is what you're gonna get. Santos is always right. Santos was right about Ray. Santos was right about Carlito. And earlier I told you, Dragon Lee would become a cautionary tale for what happens when you cross Santos Escobar. This is what happens. So now, whatever comes ahead of me, I don't care, Byron, because I'm about to celebrate such a dominant and victory. The two words we learned today. See you around.
The social media reaction continues from this match. Stephanie says, to no one's surprise, Santos against Dragon Lee was amazing. Stephanie, we agree. This one's for you, Ray. We all saw exactly what Santos was saying. Santos Escobar is the future, bro. Ain't no denying it. I wonder what Rey Mysterio thinks of that. And then Zelina Vega sighing. We saw her fallout with Santos Escobar on Friday Night SmackDown. Very difficult for Zelina to watch all of this unfold, as Santos was someone that she truly trusted. It was someone that was part of her family that brought LWO together. But Santos has moved on, and he's focused on domination.
That's a confident man. Santos was right. Is a phrase I don't think we're going to hear or stop hearing anytime soon. Zelina Vega, remember, came together with Legado del Fantasma when they came to SmackDown, then became part of the LWO. On the night Rey went into the Hall of Fame, think of the year that she's had and has now watched it all fall apart at the hands of Santos Escobar. Ryan, not somebody I would want to make mad at Zelina Vega.
No, and I think that's the one thing that Santos has to be mindful of as this moves forward. I'm not exactly sure he will be, but I don't think you want to get Zelina Vega from like a 4 to a 10 in terms of her rage scale. Size right now, it was a rough night for the LWO. We don't know how Carlito is. They have a lot of pieces to put back together. Santos Escobar believes everything he's doing is correct, that he's in the right. I think that's a very dangerous place for the LWO to be. They need to figure out how to flip that on its head as this thing moves forward.
And I know that Santos is very confident right now, but we talk about this all the time in WWE, the strength in numbers. LWO is obviously pretty beat up right now, but could there come a time when the strength in numbers helps sort of level things with Santos Escobar? And is he mindful?
I don't think he cares.
He's trying to fracture them. Yeah. He did it to Rey. He did it to Carlito before they could even have a match. Someone who admires them, who was stepping up for them, Dragon Lee, took care of him tonight.
He doesn't need anybody.
He doesn't want anybody.
I also think he believes that he is the LWO.
He had them. He was with them. They brought somebody else in. He's saying, we had enough here. Why wasn't this enough? For one night, backlash in Puerto Rico, sure. Bring out Savio. Bring out Carlito. Let's have a good time.
Now?
You need Carlo. You need Carlito? You need that to be part of the LWO? According to Santos, no. So, yeah, Santos on his own is, I think, what he wants because he didn't get what he wanted with the LWO.
That's a confident man in Santos Escobar, looking to take on all who are coming after him by himself. Well, we have a busy week coming ahead in WWE. Lots to talk about as the landscape has changed, as Survivor Series went off the air. And we have a very exciting episode of WWE's The Bump coming your way this Wednesday, 1 p.m. Eastern. As always, with the crew, myself, Ryan Pappolla, Matt Camp. You guys won't want to miss a second of that. But that will do it from our recap show here on The Bump. Thank you all so much for watching, and we'll see you guys on Wednesday.